The governor of the great state of South Carolina, the Honorable Henry McMaster.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Elliott. Y'all stand in this cold, so I will be very brief. Thank you all for that standing ovation. Appreciate that very much. I got a new man on the staff. There he is down there, and he's not from here. And I'm introducing him to the state. And as we rode up, of course, we could see the silhouette of the Blue Ridge, see the mountains. And if you go in the other direction far enough, you'll come to what they call the Piedmont and the sand. You cross rivers everywhere you go, and you keep going, you get to the low country where you have the marshes and the swamps, and then finally to the beach, the most beautiful in the world. And I was explaining to Ryan Flynn about why people want to come to South Carolina. One reason is the weather. It's a lot colder in Minnesota than it is here. Now, this is, doesn't get much colder than this and doesn't stay cold very long. But the reason that people come, that businesses invest here, and I'm sure it's the same story with Horton, which is a fantastic company, a leader, and that is the people. So I want to tell you, just briefly, these businesses that I talk to that are all over the world, some speak in different languages through interpreters. When they come and look at South Carolina, they come back to invest hundreds of millions, billions of dollars, and there's a great risk. If you invest and build in the wrong place, there are consequences for that. So they don't want to do it. They're very careful. And we have businesses that could go anywhere in the United States, businesses in the United States that expand anywhere in the United States, and they're coming to South Carolina, and we are growing. And we're growing in the right kind of ways, and a lot of reasons. We have the best technical college system in the United States, research universities and four-year colleges that cooperate with all of higher education works together, the mountains, the oceans, the things that I mentioned, the temperature, the weather. We've got all of that, but the main thing all these companies tell me is it's the people. There was one company from Japan, I never will forget. They said the three reasons why we've come to South Carolina, the people, the people, the people. The chairman of BMW said, South Carolina is a handshake state. When someone from South Carolina gives you their word, you know you've got it. They're dependable, they're smart, they're tough, and they're loyal. Mark Clark, four-star general, World War II, you remember later President of the Citadel, said there's more patriotism per square inch in South Carolina than any place in the world. And he'd been all over the world. So that's why we are succeeding. That's why we are either first or second in growth in the Southeast. That's why we did not close down our economy because of the virus. We found a way to stay open. We had to limit those close contact places like barbershops, beauty parlors, concerts, but we didn't close down the other things as they did in other states. And we'll tell you, we're not going to do that. Why? Because it's not necessary. When you have good people, you can do just about anything. And I can say that you have good people. This is a good company, and these are good people. And that's why South Carolina is succeeding. So I would want to urge all of you to, anytime you get a chance, to talk to the young people of our state. Give them confidence in the future. We're going places. If you want to go someplace, South Carolina is the best place to be. But always tell them that this is the best place, South Carolina, with our people, is the best place on the earth to live, work, and raise a family. And that's the truth. And I have a memento to symbolize our appreciation, our welcome to the company. What? Senator Thomas Alexander wanted to be here, but he's fighting battles in Colombia, and he was involved in your decision to come. He was one of the ones, Thomas Alexander, that wanted to be sure that this event, that this company took root here. So on behalf of 5.1 million proud, happy South Carolinians, I'd like to offer to you, Mr. DeDeets and ladies, it's a brass plate with our state seal and our motto, which is Dum Spiro Sparrow, which means while I breathe, I hope. And we are breathing real good, and we're hoping, and we know that today is we're making a great start, but it's only going to get better. So we thank you very much.
Thank you, Governor.
Thank you.
Well, Governor, thank you again for the time today.
Yes, sir.
I know you had that press conference this morning in Columbia
yep.
with Superintendent Spearman. Just wondering at this point, is there any rough timeline for when teachers might be able to get a vaccine?
Well, right now we are concentrating on those who may die if they get the virus. That's been the thrust of the CDC. The CDC just recently recommended that those 65 and older be allowed first access. So we started off with the hospital staff and some first responders, all of whom keep us alive, get us to the hospital where they can keep us alive. But now we've moved down to 70-year-olds and above, and just recently to 65-year-olds and above. Those are the ones that are at the risk of actually dying from the disease. The younger people face very, very reduced risk, and some hardly at all. So to open the vaccination process at this point up to those younger than that would be a big mistake, because every shot that you take from an older person and give someone to younger who's healthy, it's you're subjecting that older person to actually dying from the virus. Not a good idea. The Senate is talking about it now. I don't know what they're going to decide, but we have a good system going now. We've had frustrations. We're still frustrated it's not going fast enough, but we know that we must vaccinate or offer to the older citizens a chance to be vaccinated before we go down and take it away and give it to others. So that's what we're being asked to do. That's the debate that's in the Senate today. It's not a good idea. We right now have 322,000 appointments made by people, most of them the elderly people, to get their vaccinations. We do not want to cancel those appointments in order to put younger people at the head of the line, younger people who have a very, very reduced risk as compared to the older people.
Part of this, too, was making sure that more students get back in the classroom, schools across the state. I'm wondering, I know for some schools it's a bit more challenging than others. In the Greenville County School District, they're right now at 75%, but I know that they've said that getting to 100% is going to be a bit tricky. Will there be assistance from the state on how
we have offered all the assistance there is. Almost every private school in the state has been full-time, face-to-face, 5 days a week from the very beginning. There are, I think, 27 school districts right now that are 5 days face-to-face from the very beginning. There's less spread in the schools than any other place in the state, according to statistics. The very few students there are. The spread recently in Charleston, 38,000 students inside the classrooms, inside the schools, was virtually zero. Those people who got the virus were some of the teachers and some of the staff, and they were spreading it to each other. It is not spreading in the schools. All of these children need to be in school 5 days a week. There's absolutely no excuse for that not being done at this time. Those school districts or those schools that don't think they know how to do it, they can look at some of those that are doing it. Even the CDC says vaccinations are should not be a requirement to open in schools. We've got to educate. We've got to have these children back in schools. The unintended consequences for keeping them out are enormous, and we'll be paying for it for years. So the districts need to open those schools. We need to get the teachers, get the students back in there. And as I say, there's virtually no spread at all in these classrooms, in the schools. So there's no reason why every school in South Carolina can't be operating full time, face to face, right now. If the legislature wanted to do something constructive, they could pass a law requiring them to go back. If I had the authority, I would do it. But you have to, where there's a will, there's a way. If the districts want to open up, there's plenty of protective equipment, there's plenty of help to help them do that. They need to get open those schools up.
So you would not endorse that bill in the Senate right
no.
now that went into pre-committee?
No, that's a bad idea. I don't think the senators have all the facts. I don't think they know that the CDC has said that vaccinations of teachers and support people and principals and all is should not be necessary for opening back up. I don't know that they know that there's less spread in the schools than virtually any other place in the country. The suffering, the ramifications, both for the economy, for the jobs. We're requiring parents to choose between the education for their children and their jobs. They got to stay home with the children and not go to work. The children need to be in school for 100 different reasons, and there's no reason why they're not there right now.
One last question.
Did you have a question?
I was going to ask. You just said there are hundreds of thousands of people already in line for the vaccine that have signed up.
322,000.
Yeah. So with moving to vaccinate 65 and older now on Monday, do you feel like that's...
Some of those are the 65 and older. They've made appointments.
Okay.
When we opened it up a few days ago and suggested that we would open it up before that, they got on the phone and made their appointments. And we have a lot of 70, 71, 78, 79, 80, 90-year-olds that are in line for, they've made appointments for those shots. And you get your first shot, and then for Pfizer, you come back 3 weeks later for your second. For Moderna, you come back 4 weeks later or so. So the people are in line to get that first dose, and we don't want to cancel those appointments and put anyone ahead of them, particularly the younger people who are not at risk.
Are you happier now than how it went maybe 2 or 3 weeks ago?
Oh yeah, it's doing much better now than it was then. There was a lot of miscommunication. We had to get with the hospitals and explain exactly what was expected of them. And we provided assistance where they needed it, but there was really a lot of misunderstanding. But some of those hospitals are over 100% now of their doses, because the doses, the bottle, the vial is scheduled for 5, but you can actually get 6 shots out of it. So we have some of our hospitals that have done enormously well that are actually over 100% of the number of doses they've been given. But still, we have hundreds of thousands, 322,000 appointments that have already been made now for those 65 and older, and I presume some of the hospital personnel that are ready, that are waiting their turn. We cannot upset that system. The system is running smooth now. It's not fast enough, and there's still some weak spots, and I can promise you we're working on those. But to put a younger group in ahead of them now would be, it'd be unjust, it'd be unwise, it'd be unconscionable, it would be unethical to take a vaccine away from someone who may die if they get the virus and give it to someone who's younger and healthy and facing no risk. We just can't do that. And I think if all the senators and House members understood that, and frankly, I think if a lot of the teachers and the district personnel, those are the ones that make the decisions in the school district, if they all knew what we knew, what we're trying to tell them, I think you'd have a different response.
Awesome. Thanks, guys.